So that object was moving nearly twice as fast as previous things in space. So what made the speeds and size so remarkable to what we've seen in the past?
Well, first thing, it implied that it came from outside the solar system because gravity cannot bind it to the sun. It was moving too fast for that. And the other thing is that the object was relatively big, possibly tens of kilometers the size of Manhattan Island. And if that's the case, it was a million times more massive than the previous objects from outside the solar system. And that was puzzling. It also came in the same plane as the planets around the sun, within 5 degrees. And the chance for that happening at random is 1 in 500. And then when we obtained the best image of it, it looked as if there is a glow ahead of the object towards the sun, instead of the typical tail that we see behind comets away from the sun. And that glow was cigar-shaped. It was 10 times longer than wide. And it's just not clear what this object is. There is a cloud of gas around it that is mostly carbon dioxide. And there is nickel without iron in it. And the only way that nickel is produced without iron is in the industry when we make nickel alloys. So it raises the question of whether this is a typical comet, a natural object, or maybe something technological. And of course, we will get a much better sense in the coming weeks because it will come very close to Mars on October 3rd. We will be able to get a high resolution image of it from the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter that was deployed by NASA around Mars. And that image will have a pixel resolution of about 30 kilometers. So it would be 100 times better than the previous image we had from the Hubble Space Telescope. And then in March 2026, it will come very close to Jupiter. And there we can employ a spacecraft called Juno to probe it. So altogether, we'll get much more data about it. And, you know, that's the fun of doing science. It's like a detective story. We don't know the nature of the object until we get more data about it.
And you mentioned the glow on this image, which we're not exactly sure exactly what it is. Is that what is leading to maybe this theory that some people think that this could be an alien ship?
Well, it's a possibility. And I define the scale where zero means it's a natural object and 10 means that it's a technological object that poses a potential threat to humanity. And we need to be aware that when objects come into the solar system, you know, that one out of all these objects might be a spacecraft because we launched five of them out of the solar system, Voyager 1, Voyager 2, Pioneer 10, Pioneer 11, and New Horizons. So, you know, we are relatively new on the cosmic block. You know, the sun formed only in the last one third of the history of our galaxy, the Milky Way galaxy. And there are billions of Earth-Sun analogs in the Milky Way galaxy, and someone could have predated us, and you know, they could have arrived at our backyard, and we've never looked. Now we have the ability to search for such objects. There is a new telescope in Chile called the Rubin Observatory. It was just inaugurated. It was funded by the National Science Foundation and the Department of Energy, and it will potentially find a new interstellar object of this type every few months, and that would be amazing. And we are entering a new era where we can check if we have a cosmic neighbor based on the possibility that there might be a tennis ball in our backyard.
Now, NASA scientists have said that this object looks a lot like a comet, and they said it does, quote, comet-like things. Can you break that down for us? What exactly do they mean by that?
Right. So what they mean is there is gas detected around this object, but we would have expected it to be rich in water, but water makes only 4% of that cloud of gas. It's mostly carbon dioxide based on data from the Webb telescope. We see this glow of light, but usually around comets, the glow is produced by dust, and the dust it scatters sunlight, and then the dust is pushed back by sunlight, and that's why we see a cometary tail trailing behind comets. In this case, the glow is in front of the object towards the sun, and it's not really clear why. And why is it 10 times longer than it is wide? One possibility is that instead of dust, what we are seeing is scattering of sunlight by ice, by fragments of ice that gets evaporated, but it's not at all clear. And I would caution that we need more data before we figure out the nature of this object, and we should always keep in mind the possibility that it's not a rock.
And speaking of that, it kind of leads into my next question. Obviously, there's a lot of public fascination here, but of course, we're talking about alien theories. Sometimes that can overshadow actual science. So how can scientists like yourself maybe strike that perfect balance between addressing speculation and also highlighting some real new discoveries?
Well, science is an opportunity to learn something new. So we shouldn't always behave like the adults in the room that know the answer in advance. It's an opportunity to maintain your childhood curiosity. And so the beauty of science is that you are guided by data, by evidence, and it's like a detective story. The more evidence we have, the better we can get to the bottom of what really is the nature of such an object. And that's a lot of fun as long as you allow yourself to be open-minded. So we will see how things develop in the coming month or two. I already got a message from a fan that said that he's trading against options on the volatility of the stock market in case it turns out to be technological. The stock market may crash. And of course, there is the bigger question, if we have a partner, a cosmic partner out there, we need to look for it, to search for evidence. And if we find it, we might learn about new technologies, new science that we don't possess. It will change our perspective about our place in the universe. And it could inspire us, if they are much more accomplished than we are, we might start to explore space much more meaningfully, instead of investing most of our resources in conflicts on this rock that we were born on. We might actually, in the words of President Reagan, we might come together because we are all in the same boat, all humans on Earth, and perhaps that will bring us to a better future.
And you mentioned maybe evidence and data. What exactly are astronomers trying to gain from this image?
Right. So what data is collected from telescopes, and we have a lot of them on Earth. But the problem is this object on October 29th will come closest to the sun. So it will be the brightest, the best target for us to observe from Earth. Except the only problem is the sun will be in our way. It will be on the opposite side of the sun. So then we need to employ telescopes or cameras that are in space, for example, those around Mars or Jupiter. These are spacecraft that were launched by NASA a long time ago, and we can use them to look at the object when it comes close to Mars, close to Jupiter. So basically, data is all the information you can collect by looking through sort of a magnifying glass of a telescope, and you can search for an image, a high resolution image of the object, so that you can tell out of that whether it's a rock or something else. That would be the best. But another possibility is that the object, if it's technological, it would maneuver, or it would release some mini probes, and or it will broadcast some signal, or it will have some artificial lights coming off it, not just reflection of sunlight. All of these could be signatures that it's technological and not a rock. This is a blind date of interstellar proportions, meeting an object from outside the solar system that we've never seen before. And of course, if you go on a blind date, you don't know what to expect. If you have a rock on the other side, it is interesting because you learn about what makes the backyard of other stars, other types of rocks. And we might learn about what is the composition of that rock. Maybe it has the building blocks of life on it, if we can bring some material to Earth. But if it ends up being technological, we will know that not only there is life out there, but intelligent life. And that is very exciting. And then, when you go on a blind date, the fundamental question is, will the other side be friendly or a serial killer? You know, you never know when you go on a blind date. So we should always be cautious. Jim, if there is a technological object that we identify, it will obviously change the way we behave in the future. We will need to deploy, you know, a network of interceptors or sensors that would alert us to threats in the future.
Professor Avi Loeb from Harvard University, thanks so much for your time this afternoon and for your perspective.
Thank you so much for having me.